Amiodarone is truly in a class by itself. If you're a fan of Dickens, you might say it's the best of times, it's the worst of times. So let me explain that to you. I started using Amiodarone early in my career in the early 1980s before it was actually an approved drug. There are a bunch of us who were investigating it. We were fortunate enough to write some of the early papers on it. But we were using it back then mainly for life-threatening ventricular arrhythmias. And by the way, to the best of my knowledge, that's still its indication. Okay, so guidelines clearly tell you you can use this drug. But if you actually look in these package inserts, you'll probably find out that for the most part, it'll still say it's for life-threatening rhythms. So here's what you need to know. It's a drug that's extremely effective, often will work where no other drugs work. It's a drug that has to be handled with care, and not everybody is a candidate for it. So, knowing that some of the major side effects have to do with lung toxicity, liver, and thyroid, but not as high as in the old days when we used larger doses, don't go by this 10% and 5%, all those numbers. I've been using this drug for decades, and my numbers aren't anywhere near that high. But we're using lower doses than we used to. Every patient should undergo pre-amiodarone testing, a chest x-ray, pulmonary function tests, including what's called a DLCO, which measures diffusion capacity in the lungs, liver enzymes, and thyroid testing. We do all that as our pre-amiodarone screen. Every now and then, you find a person, and you feel bad about it, because you know what you have to tell the patient, actually has severe lung disease they didn't know about, and they're not a candidate for amio. That'll be clear, but then the patient unfortunately has to deal with this other problem they didn't know was there. So once we clear a patient, we will start them on the drug, but we review carefully with everyone before they start all the risks and the benefits, and we don't use it unless other options aren't available to us. You could do ablation, but some patients would rather take amio than ablation. That is a patient preference. That's not my preference. Patients have a right to choose what they want. And if they choose that, then you have to make sure there's no drug-drug interactions. For example, some statins, doses not all, depends on the metabolism of statin, have to be lowered. So what occurs is the following. First of all, you do preliminary testing, make sure it's safe to use. Second of all, you've had a discussion with the patient, they know risks and benefits. Third of all, you tell them to stay out of the direct sunlight because you can get really photosensitivity with the drug. You have to prepare the patient for all these. Then you look at their drug list, make sure there's nothing you have to alter. Get them off a certain statin, lower the dose of a statin. If they're on warfarin, you have to manage through that. And then you follow them. Everybody, I shouldn't say everybody, people have different ways of following them. My own way of following patients is every 6 months to repeat those tests, not the pulmonary function tests. Chest x-ray, liver, thyroid function tests, I repeat every 6 months, and I usually get an amiodarone level, but I get that level often in the three-month period. You'd be surprised how variable the level is for the same dose. Remember, it's not a dose of amio, it's a level you try to get to. And if you've given someone just a pill a day, but their level's too high, you cut back on it. So you have to just manage them over time, and you tell them to let you know if they have any shortness of breath or a cough. These are early signs of lung problems. And you'll find if you do that, honestly, the drug will be very safe to use, realizing some people will have problems with it. The concept that no one should get amio is absurd, because there are some people that's the only drug that works. And who are you to tell them they should be miserable their whole life? You know, it's a patient choice. It's a risk benefit, a discussion with the doctor and the patient. And patients have a right to make a decision there.